Hi guys, Guillaume here. I hope you're all as well as I'm doing today, sitting next to the UK's most famous fro, Rabea Massaad.
Hello.
How are you doing, man?
I'm all right, how are you?
I'm very fine, very hot. And
it is incredibly warm in here right now.
It is.
So I'm sweating my face off because I've got a teapot cozy on my head. It's a natural occurrence.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
True. I didn't even think of that.
It is proper insulation for the skull, man.
Can't imagine. Man, I feel like you've been here part-time lately.
I was going to say, yeah. I mean, it feels like yesterday I was here.
Yeah.
But it was like maybe a month ago.
Yeah, right. And like those are all legitimate reasons for you to be here, because today's not Dolce or Chapman.
It's not.
It's Victory
amplification.
Indeed.
Yeah.
So today we're going to go through the Countess.
Yep.
So this is the V30.
Mm-hmm.
Version of it, and that's the big one.
That's the Super Countess, yeah, V130, which I'm sat conveniently right in front of, so you can't see it.
I guess, that won't pick it up.
Nice.
I guess, can you start, run us through your relationship with Victory? How did you end up with Victory amps?
Well, I guess, to cut a long story relatively short, it would be that they'd done the V30 and it was really well received, this whole lightweight lunchbox head that weighed very little and you could take it on the plane. Of course, for Guffrey Govan, who is using the Countess, that was his kind of main amp that he came out with. And that was so well received and everything was going really well. And then they did the V40, the Duchess, which I believe Mick Taylor, who you may have seen, has already done a video with Chris. And then that was a huge success, this nice bluesy clean amplifier. So then the natural progression from there between leady solo amplifier to bluesy amplifier was then, well, let's make a heavy amplifier. So I was called up. I was called up by the guys at Victory, and they were like, we're looking to make a metal amplifier, and it has to be exactly the same footprint as the V30. So it has to be in the lunchbox head, it's seven dials on the front, and it has to be around that side. Would you be interested in helping design it? Of course, I was like, that's the coolest possible question anyone's ever asked. Working with Martin Kidd, who's just an absolute genius when it comes to amplifiers. So I jumped at the opportunity and I got to bring in a lot of my influences and input in terms of tastes of sound of guitar, tones and all this kind of stuff.
In terms of tone dialing, or did you go through a selection of tubes, for example, and try to see which one was?
It was a combination of things such as taking my favourite guitar tones from recordings of bands that I listen to, along with amplifiers that I like, that I used in different combinations, because I was experimenting a lot with stereo rigs at the time. So there was loads of all that kind of stuff. And it was really a process of me turning up to the Victory headquarters and being playing through an amp and going, Could it have a little more mid? And then Martin would walk away and he'd go, okay, how about now? And okay, cool. There's something a little bit fizzy in the top end. Can we reduce that? So, it was very much that kind of process until we arrived with the Kraken, which I'm very pleased to say was a name that came out of this little head. I was like, it's going to be a beast of an amplifier. And then I thought, Kraken's a great name.
It is an absolutely great name.
Yeah, and so that was really well received. The Kraken came out, did really, really well. Yeah. Everyone really enjoyed it. And then the following, so that was 2 years ago now. So at the end of last year, beginning of this year, I was rung up again by Victor and they were like, look, we want to offer you a position in the R&D team, working not only with Martin on designing amplifiers and tweaking things, but also doing video demos, doing clinics, doing tours and all that, like what I'm doing here. And as far as opportunities go, that was a really awesome opportunity, and I've been very lucky to be offered the position and also very happy to take it. So that's led up to this point,
Right. And you've done a great job with it. I mean, I'm a massive fan of the Kraken.
Thanks, man.
I got to try this one first time last week. I was telling you about that earlier.
Yeah.
I was in the amp showroom.
Yeah.
And that little thing, that lunchbox, got up to 135 decibels on volume one.
Yeah, it's intense, man.
It's just like, it's unreal compared to the size of it.
And that's the thing.
It looks nice. It looks nice and clean, but
they're sleek and they pack a punch.
Yeah, they do.
But and then so following on from that, I helped tweak the V40 Deluxe with all the team, with Mick and everyone else. And then the last project that me and Martin had to finish off was the V130, the Super Countess. So in the sense that, you know, you had a clean channel and an overdrive channel, but not only that, we decided that a clean should also have a crunch, and then the overdrive should have two voices. Sure. So it's four modes, essentially, which we thought was a nice improvement. Not necessarily improvement, but a nice upgrade in terms of functionality from the smaller lunchbox head. And also, we listened to some feedback on what people thought of the Countess. Loads of people really, really loved it for like lead playing and all that kind of stuff. And we had a couple of comments, people saying, you know, we really, really love the voicing. It'd be nice if we could have a brighter voicing as well. So of course we decided,
because it's a fairly dark,
it's reasonably dark voice, but it's stunning for leads.
Oh yeah, 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 definitely.
But if you want that tight, chuggy rhythm sort of stuff, it's harder to achieve that from the Countess, whereas the Super Countess, we added that second voice on an overdrive channel, which means one voice has a bit less low end, is a bit pokey in the mid-range, and then the second voice is fatter bottom end and slightly more scooped. So that's good for two reasons, one being, you know, chugging away and getting different dynamics out of humbucker guitars. Mm. But then if you get a single coil and have a go, it's supported really nicely.
Yeah, yeah. It's got to stay true to that single coil then.
Yeah.
That's cool.
So it was a good process, and I think the result is awesome because you've got four incredibly usable modes, 100 watts, you know, then you've got your effects loop. And
yeah, that's what surprised me the most, to be honest, because I thought the Countess was sort of a very misleading name. Like, it's like the Kraken, you can't go wrong. It's like, it's going to be violence. Going to be trouble. But the Countess, you're like, meh.
Sounds relatively
clean,
well to do.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. And then you just crank it up and
it's fierce. It is fierce.
Yeah, yeah. Like the level of versatility in those amps is just insane. And you can go from the cleanest of cleans to like proper metal sounding.
So maybe I should take you through the tones of the Super Countess, seeing as I'm already plugged into it.
Definitely.
It's probably worth pointing out what's on the floor just before I do that. I've got, in the effects loop, I've got GFI System Specular Reverb 2, which I've been loving at the moment. And I got the Walrus Audio ARP87 delay, which you've also got, because it's beast. It's awesome. And then in the front, I literally have my brand new Keeley Electronics D&M drive that I was given by the wonderful Mick Taylor. And I've just been experimenting with it, but I'm going to turn all the pedals off just so I can give you tones. And of course, I'm using my Chapman ML3 Beer guitar. And yeah, so it's a humbucker guitar. I'm going to get the Strat down in a minute as well so I can show you. But this, we'll go through the clean channel first. You know, it's spanky as well.
It is.
And then on your neck, pick up that kind of. Again, it's just a nice clean channel, you know? It's dynamic and you can get a lot out of it if you need to. And the cool thing is that, again, because you've now got the crunch voicing on the same channel, you can ride the gain of the clean channel relatively high. And if you're using a humbucker guitar, it's gonna break up a little bit. Yeah. I mean, it's pokey.
Yeah, it is.
It's more clean than it is breakup. It's like full headroom kind of thing. But as soon as if I then go ahead and just chuck in the crunch now, so you've got. It's probably worth saying that this is in drop C, so it does sound a little low, but Let me just wind it back down and give you an example of the levels of sort of saturation you can get out of the crunch channel. So this being with gain at around 9 o'clock. And I'm gonna chuck in some reverb and delay so you can get an idea of what it sounds like. So that with the gain at 9 o'clock, you know, it's just a bit of breakup.
Yeah, but it's so, like, it warm. Sounds full.
It does, doesn't it?
Full tone is just insane.
And I mean, it's probably worth me chucking on the single coil on this setting just so that you can hear the difference. There you go. For all those wondering, this is my newest guitar and I'm in love with it. It's a Fender Custom Shop 61
for
Strat.
For good reasons, yeah.
Really happy with this. So now single coil on the same settings, haven't changed anything. So it's quite clean, yeah. You know? But if I now put the gain up to just under halfway. Which is, it's woody.
Yeah.
But, you know, slam it over. And it's
got a nice swing as well.
It's quite open, but, you know, and you can, and if you chuck a boost, the D&M boost in front. So, it takes pedals well.
It does.
I should just carry on winding it up, shouldn't I? So, now we're just under, just below 3 o'clock. So of course, it's thick, even with a single coil. Yeah. But now if I go back to a humbucker again, this is 15K output humbucker on the bridge. But if I play. It allows you to do quite a lot on just the one channel. Yeah. You know, you got two modes on this one channel going between clean and crunch. And I just think there's so much you can do with that.
Yeah.
You know, and then that's even before we've got into like heavy riffage, so, shreddy territory.
Yeah, because for those of you who might have tuned in at that moment, exactly, that was just one channel.
Yeah, that is literally the clean channel. Yeah.
It's insane.
So I think at this point, if I just now slam over to, I'm gonna take the gain down to just above 3 o'clock on the overdrive. And we're gonna be on voice one. So this is the overdrive. And that's quite low gain.
Yeah.
Well, I wouldn't say low gain, you know what I mean? It's a little
compared
bit
compared to what you can get.
Yeah. Now around halfway. So again, it's not overly like, what would I say? It's definitely not like a metal sound, but it's got so much sustain.
Then again, what kind of metal?
And it's tight.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
It is.
So because there's quite a lot of mid-range there, as you can hear, and just to point out that the EQ is roughly at 12 o'clock, the bass is slightly rolled off, but everything's at 12, you know. If I, that's with less mid. So yeah, that was with the mids rolled back a little bit, so you get a little bit more of a scoop tone. Now if I push the gain to around 2 o'clock, it's quite a lot of gain now, but you can get a really nice lead tone, very saturated. So it's, you know what I mean? It's still, with the gain nearly that high, it's not overkill.
No. It's just a nice, natural, sustained and distortion. And it's
kind of similar to the V30 Countess. Like, the Countess is still a little bit darker than that.
Yeah.
But it's got the same, like, warmth as the distortion.
Oh, yeah.
It's nowhere near as edgy as the Kraken, but it's a little bit more modern than what it used to
be.
Which is something that we did want to achieve. Again, we're still on the voice one of the overdrive. If I then slap it over to voice two, so let's just roll the gain back a little bit, and I'll give you a direct comparison. If I chug, you'll hear the difference. So voice one, and then voice two. I mean, suddenly we've got loads more low end.
Yeah.
And I would say if you were gonna be doing tight rhythm metal chugging, you want voice one.
Yeah.
And if you're doing a lot more big open swelly stuff or lead or anything like that, or using a single coil, go to voice two. That, in my opinion, then again, you know, it's up to the user.
No, it makes total sense though. It's again, just showing how many things that thing can do.
I know, it's madness. So I'm gonna do that again real quick.
Yeah.
If I go voice one. And then voice two. Way, way, way fatter.
Yeah.
So push the gain up a little bit to around 2 o'clock. Yeah, I like it. I think it sounds good. It sounds good.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's all right. It's all right. It's not too bad.
Yeah. Like if you're in the room, whoever's watching on in YouTube land, it's like it fills the entire space. Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? Like me just holding that low note stuff. Sustained for and it would have gone into that beautiful feedback as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess, I mean, I don't really know what else there is to say. It's got an effects loop, as you heard, and,
yeah.
You know, of course, with every Victory amp as well, you can knock it to half power mode, you can do single-ended mode and all that kind of stuff. So it's just, and it takes pedals really damn well. Like I say, you know, we don't need distortion pedal on this. We don't need a boost or anything in front, unless you wanted to tighten it up a bit.
Yeah.
Like for, all right, let's try just for a little bit, an example, if I use the boost, the D&M drive boost, just to see what happens.
Yeah.
As an example. So I'm gonna put the gain to where I would have had it, and bearing in mind this is fatter channel, this should hopefully tighten it up a bit. Obviously it's feeding back, but you hear less low end, so without, with. Yeah, it's good.
It is.
So I'm just going to keep ranting, you know. I'll just keep going off on one.
No, I guess not to like keep you from playing or anything.
No, not
but
at all.
I guess that I should have to say at least what that is.
Yeah.
And probably run.
We need to also run through
that just for comparison. So.